is just fantastic.
Captain's log. Subdate 220517.8. Rarely do we ever manage to pounce on a topic that can be considered hot. Today's video is the nearest we ever get to such a vaunted level. As one perp though is dead, I'm going to have to requisition a regeneration pod. This could get bureaucratic fast. Welcome everyone to the Halls of Injustice. Today we welcome two inmates to the ISO cubes, one of whom is being regenerated as we speak. They are not married, but they do share the same last name. They are Casey White and Vicky White. They are going to be here for quite some time. Casey himself was already in the ISO cubes, not within this series, for a capital murder charge, along with other charges, all of which are remarkably violent. So what I'm going to do today is tell you who they are, go through a bit about their past, and then provide you a timeline of events that brought them here, where there is zero chance of escaping. Before we do that though, I'm going to apologize for this avatar in advance. There's building work happening around here and I am running out of time to edit this video. Fingers crossed for next week though, right? So Casey Cole White was jailed in 2020 on capital murder charges in the Lauderdale County Detention Center, which is in Florence, Alabama. Back in 2020, while in prison for those crimes, he confessed to the stabbing of someone else called Connie Ridgway, a stabbing that he to this day maintains he did not do. Evidence would certainly lean in favor of that a lie. Vicky White had been with the Department of Corrections for 16 years. She was regarded as a model employee and had, just before this incident occurred, handed in retirement papers. There's a reason for that, we'll get to it momentarily, don't worry. She had, up until the moment of this incident, a spotless record and was actually meant to receive her 5th Employee of the Year award. That's how respected she was within her department. Unbeknownst to her co-workers in 2020, she began a friendship and correspondence that then turned into a relationship with Casey White, who, by the way, his total sentence is 75 years. Because he had gone on a crime spree where he shot one woman, tried to murder his ex-girlfriend, killed the dog, and held several victims at gunpoint. So yes, this was in fact a relationship match made in heaven. Did I need a sarcasm sign for that comment? The actions of Casey White and Vicky White led to an 11-day manhunt. And so now would be a good time to go through the timeline of events that led up to and include their crime. On the 18th of April, Vicky White sold her Lexington home, with public records revealing she sold the property for $95,000, which was below market value. After the sale, she had started to live with her mother. On the 28th of April, 10 days later, Vicky submits retirement paperwork to officials at Lauderdale County Jail. According to County Sheriff Rick Singleton, she had been discussing her retirement for many months and talked about going to the beach. Before the crime took place, so in a week ahead of this, Vicky purchased men's clothing at a store and visited a sex shop, because she a kinky criminal. Lauderdale County District Attorney Chris Connolly claims she also withdrew $90,000 in cash out of a series of bank accounts. Planning is after all quite important, especially for the crime she's about to commit. On April the 29th at 5:21 a.m., Vicky White checks out of a Quality Inn in Florence, Alabama. At 8:47 a.m., Transport Van 5 leaves the county jail with 7 inmates escorted by 2 deputies. At 8:56, Transport Van 2 leaves the jail with 5 inmates, also escorted by 2 deputies. At 9:20 a.m., Assistant Director Vicky White tells a deputy to prepare inmate Casey White for transport to courthouse. The deputy removes Casey White from his cell, takes him to booking and handcuffs him and shackles his legs, as is standard procedure. At 9:41, Vicky White leaves the detention center with Casey White, and they head to the courthouse for a mental health evaluation, quotations around those 3 words. She told the booking officer that she is the only deputy available who is firearm certified, and that she is dropping him off to other deputies at the courthouse. Because of the position she held, that was respected. Vicky says she's then going to Med Plus for a personal appointment. At 9:49 a.m., surveillance video shows Vicky's police cruiser parked at the nearby Florence Square shopping center parking lot 8 minutes after leaving the jail. There was not enough time for them to even attempt to try to come to the courthouse, which has been confirmed by Sheriff Rick Singleton. At 11:34 a.m., a Florence Police Department officer spots her cruiser, but naturally thinks nothing of it. At 3:30 p.m., the booking officer from back at the prison reports to administration that they've been trying to contact Vicky White to check on her, and that her phone is going directly to voicemail. The officer also confirms that Casey White was not returned to the detention center with other inmates. At approximately 11 p.m., College Grove, Tennessee resident Jackie Adams finds Vicky's SUV with tinted windows and no tags abandoned by her home. She then reports the vehicle to the Williamson County Sheriff's officer, which had it towed. There is a 6-hour gap between Casey White being taken from the prison to the courthouse for those at the prison to then realize, jailbreak. That is not their fault. That said, one can safely surmise some form of responsibility will be laid at the feet of those that did not follow the strict protocol, regardless of one's position of authority within the corrections facility itself. On May the 1st, the U.S. Marshals Service said that it is offering up to $10,000 for information about an escaped inmate and a missing and endangered correctional officer, with the U.S. Marshals Office saying that Casey White is believed to be a serious threat to the corrections officer and to the public. It was also confirmed on the 1st of May by Rick Singleton that our policy is for any inmate with those kind of charges, capital murder and other violent-related crimes, to have two sworn deputies escort them, confirming there was no mental health evaluation scheduled for Casey White at the courthouse. With essentially a 6-hour head start, one does have to wonder what vehicle or mode of transport they had taken, along with adjustments made to their visual representation that would help them best evade capture for as long as possible. On the 3rd of May, US Marshals issued a warrant for Vicky White, charging her with permitting or facilitating escape in the first degree in connection with capital murder. And if ever there was a point of not going back, that was it. On the 4th of May, Vicky White and Casey White were seen driving around Florence in a police cruiser on gas station surveillance. The whole point of a prison break is to try and avoid detection, isn't it? A police cruiser is hardly known for subtlety. Authorities say that the Assistant Director for Corrections Vicky White and inmate Casey White had a special relationship that extended out of the officer's normal work hours and included special privileges for the inmate. This would include extra food and other privileges no one else got, with Rick Singleton pointing out that all indications point to Vicky White willingly helping Casey White escape. Due to the escape and apparent part in it, Vicky White was fired, so that resignation was, I guess, null and void. On May the 6th, Tennessee cops discover the impounded SUV that belonged to Vicky White, which spurred a force of U.S. Marshals and Williamson County Sheriff's officers, along with SWAT members, to circle back to Jackie Adams's property. Drones and helicopters then descended on the home, where they remained for hours and into the evening. At 2:15 p.m., the Williamson County Sheriff's Office tweets there is no sign the two are still in our area. On May the 7th, District Attorney Chris Conley shares how they have managed to evade capture for so long, with a theory that Vicky White is rolling Casey White dressed as a woman around in a wheelchair, with other officials suspecting that Vicky White may also be disguising herself as an elderly woman with a grey wig. At this point, over 100 investigators are involved in the search for Casey White and Vicky White, with Border Patrol being on alert since April the 29th. It was around this time that the U.S. Marshals Services offer up an additional $5,000 for any information regarding Vicky White, and both were, up to now, still considered dangerous, especially as it was known that one of them was armed. On May the 9th, 11 days after this all began, and after a lengthy car chase in Indiana, Evansville, Indiana, Vicky White and Casey White were arrested. But this isn't where the story ends. See, while Casey White may have gotten out of the car in one piece and, well, looked like this, Vicky White had allegedly shot herself fatally rather than be arrested, which means for her part in the crime, she will never face justice for it, which is where we at the Halls of Injustice take great issue with it. Casey White is unlikely to see the light of day ever again. He is serving 75 years, with more years more than likely going to be added on for the Connie Ridgway murder. Add any additional years with this, I doubt the 38-year-old man is ever leaving that prison alive. It was investigated that perhaps Casey White had shot Vicky White, and currently there is an extradition process to have him, Casey White, taken from Indiana back to Alabama. As far as sentences that we here would administer to both of them, it's obviously life, but they will be put through regeneration cycles so that their version of life is an eternal torture working in a labor mine on Titan.